الحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا. وصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: ولا تقف ما ليس لك به علم، إن السمع والبصر والفؤاد كل أولئك كان عنه مسؤولا، ولا تمشي في الأرض مرحا، إنك لن تخرق الأرض ولن تبلغ الجبال طولا. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله. اللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أمين رب العالمين. In Surah Al-Isra, about the 23rd ayah onwards, 17th Surah of the Quran, there are a set of ayat about which Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma says these are the ayat that are the equivalent of what Bani Israel was given, the famous term we use is the Ten Commandments, the essential principles and guidance for that community. The Quran's rendition of that, the Quran's version of that also appears in Surah Al-Isra, also close to Bani Israel. And in these 18 or 20 ayat or so, Allah Azza wa Jalla gives fundamental guidance for a community, starting with family life, parents, and then moving on to finances, and then criminal law, and just essentials of what a community needs to be abiding by in order to be a healthy community. Towards the tail end of that passage are these two ayat that I'd like to share with you, in this instruction that was originally also given to Bani Israel, and now is being, it's so valid that it's being continued and given to us as well. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَلَا تَقْفُوا مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عَلِمٌ. Don't pursue. The word qafa in Arabic, an interesting word, one of the meanings of a qafa is the back. When you follow somebody closely, like you're right behind their back. From it, you know, different words are formulated from it in the Arabic language, and another word is used in the Quran when Allah sent prophets one after another, qafayna min ba'dihim. He sent them one after another continuously. Qafa also means to follow exactly in the footsteps of somebody else. So the ayah, you know, a close word in Arabic to that is al-ittiba'. You know, وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ وَلَا تَتْبَعْ. Don't follow. But this means don't follow very closely and precisely. It's talking about a very particular kind of human behavior. When we have something in our tradition, in our culture, in our family, maybe something in our country, in our society, that everybody follows. And everybody follows it exactly. And so you follow it too. You do it too. And you have been doing it for some time, so you get used to doing it. And human beings, you know, we're creatures of adab. We're creatures of habit. So when you do something for a long time, you get used to doing it. You don't question it anymore. It just becomes a part of your life. And it's very difficult for human beings to change their behavior. It's very different to change the way you were doing things and, you know, do something else. It's very, very difficult. You know, especially like, for example, even psychologically, something like learning a new language later on in life can be very difficult, as opposed to picking up that habit earlier. That's why children, we're supposed to get instilled what happens into our children at an early age, because as they get older, making new habits that will stick for life is very difficult. How many of you try to go on a different kind of diet, or go try to do some exercise, and say, I'm going to make this a regular part of my life? It's very hard to make those changes later on. But something you've been following early on in life is easier to stick to. This is true of behavior, it's also true of ideas and beliefs and thoughts and the way you understand things, your opinion of certain things. When you have an opinion about something for a long time, it's very hard to change your opinion. Allah Azza wa Jalla gives a warning here. He says, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ. A rough translation suggests, don't follow what you don't have knowledge of. Don't become so committed to something you have no knowledge of. But the Arabic of the ayah is very beautiful. First of all, the word ma. You know, in Arabic, you can say alladhi, what you don't have knowledge of. You can say ma. Ma is more ambiguous. So already Allah is talking about something that you really don't know at all. It's a mystery to you. Why you do it, you don't know. We just do things this way, that's it. A lot of times in our families, for example, there are some traditions. And if the younger in the family say, why do we do that? That's just what we do. And the parent gets angry answering the child, you know why? Because he doesn't know the answer either. That's why he gets angry. Just do it. Just be quiet and do it. This is how we do things. So Allah says it's already a mystery to you. And then He says, لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. He doesn't say, مَا لَا تَعْلَمُ. What you don't know. He says, what you don't own in terms of knowledge. لَلَامْ is دَامِ مِلْكِيَا. We say something you own. Meaning you don't have solid knowledge of what you're following. You don't even know a little bit about it. You have no ownership of it. What it also suggests is that when we follow something, we should have solid knowledge of what we're following. Not just casual, I came to know casually from some, you know, blog somewhere, or somebody texted me something, or I saw some, I overheard somewhere something. Whatever we follow, especially things we follow closely that we're very committed to, are supposed to be proper, sound, deep knowledge. It's not supposed to be hearsay. It's not supposed to be hearsay. Now that brings us to a very interesting observation. We are a religion and a civilization of a millennium and a half all over the world. You know, 1400 to 1500 years, not going, that we're this ummah. And in every tradition, there are things you pass down from one generation to another. Every, not just us, every generation, every civilization has this. And as you pass things down, you stop questioning it, you just do it. You just do things a certain way and you don't question it. I mean, think of, you know, your co-workers and your friends at your office are very educated people. And they'll celebrate Christmas, for instance. And when they celebrate Christmas, they have some idea has to do with Jesus, his birthday, etc., etc. But what's with the socks hanging from the fireplace? Where did Santa Claus come from? Where did, you know, why the gifts in the morning and, you know, the bobsled and all, where did that come from? Do most people even know? No. Do they follow it with a lot of commitment, though? Yes. They follow with a great deal of commitment, even though they really don't know what that's about. It's been passed down. Maybe there's some historical origin to it. Some historian might know, the average people don't know. The same thing starts happening with Muslims. We have certain things we follow, certain things we do, and they just get passed down, and over time, in the next generation, we just do it, we don't really know why we're doing it. Actually, that's exactly what Allah does not want from the Muslims. Every generation of Muslims should know exactly why they're doing what they're doing. That is our tradition. Our tradition is never to become blind. Our tradition is always to have our eyes open, to know exactly what it is that we believe, what is it that we follow, and why we follow it. We're supposed to be thoroughly educated, thoroughly oriented in our religion. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. And why is that important? Let's understand why that's important before we go on to the rest of the ayah. You know, in the last 100 years, a lot of literature has been written against religions. Not just Islam, against religion in general. There's been a war against religion in the last 100 or so years. And one of the most famous quotes that's often quoted by a famous philosopher is that religion is the opiate of the masses. That religion's like a drug. People just follow it, they don't question it, and then you can control them. So the people that control a religion, if they're priests or they're rabbis, you know, or their saints, or their imams, whatever they may be, they have a power over the people. They can tell them to do whatever they want, and people will do it. And this is how people are controlled. It's just a means of control religion. They use the name of God, but it's really their own agenda they want people to follow. This is a very common and widely held belief about religion, and how people are, basically people that follow religion are stupid, they're gullible. And they're manipulated. And if you, the fact of the matter is, if you look at the history of religions in the world, what they call in philosophy organized religion, there's a lot of truth to that. People have been manipulated by religion. People have been controlled by religion. People were told, don't question it, just follow it. And then comes the religion of truth. Allah calls it Deen al-Haq. Deen al-Haq. You know, the interesting, the Arabic word haq also means to discover truth, to find truth out, to dig up something. You know, This is a religion that makes you look for the truth, not just accept it. The Messenger is commanded, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ. I call to Allah with eyes open, with clear insight. I'm not calling you to something that you should close your mind and then come to it. No. Allah Azza wa Jalla makes a complaint in the Quran to the Quraysh, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Why don't you understand? Why don't you use your brain? I want you to think about this. كَيْفَ تَعْقِلُونَ. How do you make your decisions? Allah is asking people to think, not don't think, to think. To think. Interesting, I met a Muslim, just last week I was in Little Rock, Arkansas. I met a Muslim, a young brother who became Muslim when he was 16. Only Muslim in the school, white kid. Only Muslim in the school, right? And his preacher is really worried, because it's a small town, they all go to the same church. So his preacher's been trying to talk to him for like 3 or 4 years now. So he's having a conversation with his preacher about Tawheed. And how, you know, Tawheed makes perfect sense. And you know what his preacher basically told him at the end of it? You're being too logical. You shouldn't be so logical. You just have to accept and follow something without having to make sense of it. You just have to follow it. That's it. Just do that. You know? Allah Azza wa Jalla commands the exact opposite. But you know what? We're being tricked. Our youth are also being tricked. All religions must be faultless, baseless. And our youth also are starting to think our religion is baseless. We just do what our parents do. We just come to Jum'ah because our parents bring us to Jum'ah. We just, I don't know why we have to dress a certain way, look a certain way, you know. Why we can't do this or that or the other. Your kids have questions. They say, why can't we do that? I mean, I was teaching a seminar one time and the little boy asked, how come we can't sit with the women? How come the men can't sit with the women? And what do his parents typically say?
Because it's haram. Why is it haram? Because the eye of a hand is bigger than your face. That's why. So it's haram. That's enough for you. That's it. End of story. There's no need to talk about it. No need to set the foundation.
No, this is actually the exact opposite of what Allah Azza wa Jalla wants from us. He wants us to be thinking, open-minded people. Think about it this way. I want to present it to you this way. We ask people to be open-minded when we're giving them da'wah to Islam.
We want them to consider the possibility that Islam is the truth. We want them to think about the ayat of the Quran, about the character of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
We want them to think about it with an open mind. That's what we want them to do. How can it be then that once you become Muslim, you're supposed to be cold-minded? The entire foundation of da'wah is for people to be open-minded and pursue knowledge and pursue understanding. And yet you find when people come to Islam, or people that claim to be Muslim, most of our community, when it comes to pursuing knowledge, No.
We just follow this. We don't have to look into it again. We don't have to know more. We just do it this way. We don't question it at all.
I'm not saying you have to question everything. But if your family, if your friends, the people asking you fundamental questions, you have to try and find out the answer from genuine sources. This is just part of who we are. And it's not something I'm adding as a new instruction. This is Allah Azza wa Jalla telling us way before. And He told Bani Israel before us. لَا تَقْفُمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ. And then he adds a warning.
إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا.
Very interesting ayah. I'll roughly translate it for you. No doubt about it, the hearing, the seeing, and the heart. Each of them, as far as Allah is concerned, with Allah, they are going to be asked about. They're all going to be interrogated.
In other words, Allah is saying your hearing will be interrogated, your seeing will be interrogated, and your heart will be interrogated.
And this is part of the same ayah in which Allah says, don't pursue things you don't have knowledge of. It's all one ayah. In other words, these two ideas are connected to each other. They're not two separate lessons. As far as Allah is concerned, this is the same lesson. Don't follow what you don't have knowledge of, because your hearing will be interrogated, your ears will be interrogated. What were you listening to? What were you looking at? And what judgments did your heart make? These three things, Allah Azza wa Jalla, will be kana anhu masulan. So let's talk about these three things. First of all, usually Allah says, for example, He says, وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَ. He put hearing for you, He put eyes, plural, for you, visions for you, وَالْأَفْئِدَ and hearts for you, plural. Everything is plural. But in this ayah, everything is singular. Hearing, seeing, and the heart. Everything is singular. And the benefit of that is every single person is responsible for his or her own self. I cannot say, I don't have to know this myself, I'm just following what somebody else gave me. No, you can't rely that on somebody else, you have to know for yourself. Why is it that you're committed to something? Why is it that you're following something? You should know for yourself. You should seek that knowledge yourself. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, your own hearing, your own seeing, your own qulub. Let's talk a little bit about hearing and seeing. Some of them talk about why Allah says hearing first and seeing second. Because our knowledge, the first, the most important means by which Allah delivered the most valuable knowledge, guidance, the message of the prophets, alayhi salatu wasalam, was that message seen first or heard first? It was heard first. The priority is that of listening carefully. The people of hellfire are saying, لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ. Have you only listened? Have you only paid attention? Have you only given an attentive ear? So listening is a big part of us acquiring proper education, proper understanding. We have to become a people of careful listening. إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادِ. Then let's talk a little bit about the word fu'ad. You know, there are two words in Arabic for qalb, heart. There's qalb and fu'ad. And I'll tell you something. This ayah is about being interrogated. So what you listen to, you better be careful what you listen to. You better listen to authentic, good things. Don't just listen to hearsay. Not just what you say and what you hear. What you see and what you're willing to see. Are you willing to open your eyes to reality or are you willing to not open? This is basar, literally and figuratively. Are you going to accept reality for what it is, or you're going to pretend that the world hasn't changed and you don't have to learn anything? It is the way it is. SubhanAllah, our family, so many members of our community are delusional. They're literally delusional. They don't realize where they're living and what's going on around them. They expect things to be a certain way they were used to back when they were home, you know? And they come, for example, I've seen this in masajid in our country, in this country. You'll have people that come from some country, you know, back home, and they come here, and once they walk inside the masjid, it's like they walked into Pakistan, or they walked into Hyderabad, or they walked into Somalia, or they walked into Cairo. So they expect things to be just like they were back over there. So when they see somebody that looks different, or talks different, or they see a child run one way or the other, they get really, really upset. Really upset, because they have no idea how the world has changed. And what the consequences of your anger can be upon somebody else. But regardless, I want to talk to you a little bit about the word fu'ad before we share something with you about the next ayah, inshallah. And that is that the word fu'ad means a heart that's overwhelmed. When you are overly emotional, when you get overly angry, your heart is called fu'ad. When you're really excited, your heart is called fu'ad. Fu'ad in Arabic means to roast, like on a flame. When your heart is inflamed, engulfed in flames, that's what it's called fu'ad. What Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying is, sometimes people misbehave and they blame their emotions. Listen to that carefully, folks. Sometimes we misbehave and we just blame our emotions. You say, yeah, you go home and you start yelling at your wife, and then you calm down after a while, you just go out, hang out with your friends, and you come later, sorry, that wasn't me. I wasn't myself. I just had a long day at work. It's not my fault, that was my fu'ad, you know? I get like that sometimes. Allah says, that's not going to be an excuse. I will interrogate your fu'ad to not just your qalb. I will interrogate, that's not going to be an excuse. Fathers sometimes become really abusive to their sons, yelling at them, humiliating them, cursing them out, whatever, and the mother comes into his room, to the humiliated son's room and says, don't worry, your daddy gets like that sometimes. That's not really him, that's just his fu'ad talking. That's just, he just gets like that. You know, he's really good at heart. Deep down inside, he loves you. Right? That father is not going to be able to go on judgment day in front of Allah and say, yeah, Allah, you know, I get like that sometimes. You understand, right? No. And fu'ad mas'ul. Even your overwhelmed heart is going to be absent. Then it's not just a matter of anger. It's a matter of you were depressed, you were sad, you were overwhelmed, you were afraid, you were excited, you were tempted, and you did something wrong. That's when we do things wrong, when we're overwhelmed by some kind of emotion, you know? And then you say, well, you know, it was a moment of weakness, what can I do? No, that's not how it's going to fly in Allah's court. By the way, it does fly in modern courts. I'm seeing, when I was a student of psychology, they would show us court cases of police officers that are on these car chases, and this guy's got like a Ferrari or something, so they can't catch him until he runs out of gas. But when they do catch him, they pull, drag him out of the car and give him a good old beating. And it's all caught on tape from the helicopter, right? So now they're being sued for police brutality. So the defense attorney comes and says, you know, there are certain chemicals that are released into the brain when in high pressure situations that make a person more aggressive. So if the cop didn't beat him up, it's those chemicals that beat him up.
You know, it's just a neurological function. It's not his fault entirely. The same thing they say about mob mentality. You know, people just regular everyday accounting, but a mob broke out and there's riots in the street. So he takes a baseball bat, breaks through the Best Buy, and grabs a TV. By day and an accountant by night, he's just, you know, oh, it's mob mentality. He couldn't help himself. This is a psychological phenomenon that drives people crazy. Allah says, first of all, you will all be interrogated for your individual actions. You will not be able to blame anybody else. إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصْرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. Another very powerful benefit that comes out of this ayah is that we become very adamant about things in our religion, especially the things we don't know anything about. Don't do that, that's haram.
Yeah.
You know that's haram?
Yeah, of course it's haram.
Where did you learn that it's haram?
I don't have to learn anything, I already know it's haram.
Don't do it.
Really?
You don't even have knowledge of that yourself, and you're ready to point at somebody else. What if you're wrong? What if you're wrong? You're speaking on behalf of Allah when you became Allah's ambassador to deliver to people what's halal and what's haram. Watch your mouth. Don't open your mouth about things you don't have absolute authoritative knowledge of. Don't assume that kind of knowledge. And when you do assume that kind of knowledge, then that is a form of arrogance. That's what that is. You don't need to learn anymore. I already know everything. Brother, we already know. Really, you already know. There are ulama that study 20 years and then after that they say, I don't know. And you haven't learned anything. You don't even know the alphabet properly. And you say, I already know, brother. I already know. I got to figure it out. I'm a smart guy. This is by definition what arrogance is. I bring up arrogance because that's what the very next ayah talks about. وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. Don't walk on the earth with pride. Don't walk on the earth with marah. Marah means you've accomplished something huge. You feel like you're on top of everything. You've got everything figured out, and people that you talk to are beneath you. This is marah. Don't walk around like that. Don't walk around judging people, condescending people. That's the next instruction. In other words, if you don't fulfill the first one, this is what you'll end up doing. And if you fulfill the first one, in other words, you won't pursue things, don't become committed to ideas that you don't really have sound knowledge of yourself. And on top of that, you don't even pursue it. Pursue learning about it and reading about it, or changing your opinion about it because your fu'ad is too committed to ignorance. You don't change yourself. Then obviously the next instruction is don't walk around with pride. إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَخْلِقَ الْأَرْضَ. You're not going to cause cracks on the earth. Know your place. Know your place. You know, it's interesting in our culture, as I was growing up, I noticed something about our culture in this country. It's slowly changing, but I don't see it changing fast enough. Everything that our deen, as far as character, everything that our deen praises, is looked down upon. It's very strange. In our deen, pursuit of knowledge is praise. And not just knowledge of religion, knowledge. All knowledge. Allah Azza wa Jalla here said, لَا تَقُوا عَيْسَلَكَ بِيَعِلْمُونَ. Any knowledge. All knowledge is worthy of acquisition. You're supposed to respect people that are studying anything and everything. But what do we do in our youth culture? Somebody who studies a lot is a geek. It's a loser. And somebody who cuts class and hangs out, and he's a cool kid. It's automatically the one who pursues knowledge is basically is missing out on life. The one who walks around with pride, he's got, you know, a swag in his walk. The one who has, you can't even look him in the eye, he's like, what's up, son? What you looking at? Right? That one. That's a praiseworthy quality. People want to be like him. And the one who walks on the earth with humility is a loser. He's a weakling. He's pathetic. Exact opposite. And we instill these values from the very beginning into our kids. We allow those values to be instilled. We don't say anything about them. We don't feel like we need to say anything about them. Pride isn't just in high school, by the way, among teenagers. Pride among you adults, and us adults, it manifests in a different way. We show off to people what we have. We constantly put down what other people have, how other people are dressed, where they live, what neighborhood they live in, how they have to make good financial decisions. And we constantly comment about others and what their lack of accomplishments. And we don't fail to mention our own accomplishments. This is all part of what I think you can do. Who do you think you are? It is as though Allah is talking to us like we're bugs, we're insects. They're not going to cause cracks on the earth. You're not going to prospect, you know, go past the height of the mountains. Know your place. Understand your role. These two ayat, these are concluding ayat towards the end of the instructions given to Bani Israel. And essentially the point of them was, you should learn more and become humble. That's the take-home lesson from these two ayat. You should be a person that's continually learning,
and not become a committed follower to anything you don't actually positively know. And two, remain humble. And the two go hand in hand, so I'll share with you a wisdom that comes from a famous scholar, Shabani Ghadani, rahimahullah. He was giving advice to students of knowledge, students that were studying under him. And he was talking about the benefits of seeking knowledge. And interestingly, you hear lots of benefits of seeking knowledge, but this one's very unique. I found this statement very, very unique. All he told them was, when a tree bears fruit, its branches come down from the weight of the fruit. What he's telling his students is, when you learn knowledge, it's like you're like a tree. You have no roots. But when you start learning and understanding, the fruits are coming out. And when the fruit comes out, what happens to the trees, branches? Go down. It becomes more humble. It becomes humble. A necessary result of true knowledge is humility. And if your knowledge is making you more arrogant, then maybe you've increased in ignorance, not knowledge. That's not really knowledge as far as Allah is concerned. Knowledge is supposed to make you and me more humble. It's supposed to make you realize if you acquire serious knowledge, you'll realize it's a drop in the ocean. So you'll realize how little you have. Someone who doesn't even know the ocean hasn't even tasted the drop, says, I got it all figured out. They don't even know there's an ocean ahead of them, right? SubhanAllah. This is the advice Allah in sum gives us. That we are, the thing Allah is not ever going to accept is gibr, is arrogance. It's the antithesis of our iman. And if that arrogance comes out in our conversations with each other, if it comes out in how assumingly we're very confident in our opinions about especially things that have to do with their religion, and we just say them with no fear of consequence, without properly knowing or even consulting the people that are qualified to know about those things, and we talk about these things so casually, then that is by definition what arrogance is. That is what Allah Azza wa Jalla looks down upon. Allah Azza wa Jalla, make us a people of humility, make us a people of that truly love seeking knowledge and don't speak what they don't really know about. That learn to follow and commit themselves to what they truly know. May Allah Azza wa Jalla increase the sincere knowledge of this Ummah, and by means of that genuine knowledge, may Allah Azza wa Jalla continue to increase us in our sincerity and in our humility. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayat. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله، اتقوا الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.